Hello, today we're going to be talking about procedures in assembly, specifically x86-64. We're going to be introducing the term application binary interface. We're talking a little bit about how the stack is necessary for all of this and how control transfer actually works. Then we'll talk a little bit about data transfer and local storage for procedures and wrap up by discussing some of the security issues associated with procedures. So hopefully you remember the term procedure from your introductory programming language course. So a procedure is just a portion of code that's been packaged up for reuse. And this is a really key abstraction in software development, and it provides a lot of benefits, including modularity and encapsulation, which are terms that you should have encountered at some point when you were learning how to program. If not, I would encourage you to go and look up the definitions. So there are a lot of different names for procedures. So you may have heard them called functions or methods or subroutines, and all these have slightly different meanings, but procedure is the general term that we're going to use. So a well-defined procedure has well-documented and well-typed arguments and clearly delineated return values and a very well-defined impact on program state, or no impact at all. These are known as side effects. So the problem up to this point is that it's been impossible to fully implement procedures in assembly, and that's because we've only had branching and jumping. So the core problem here is, well, once you've jumped to a procedure, once you've used the jump instruction to go to a procedure, how do you get back? So if you only have one call site, you can just hard code it, right? You can just jump back to the next instruction wherever you wanted to call the procedure. But this doesn't work once you have more than one call site because you don't know which call site you came from. So we really need a mechanism for remembering where we came from, and also for remembering any state that was important in order to get back there. We don't want to use registers for this because there are so few registers. This would really restrict our ability to have and call procedures. So we're going to want to use memory in order to store these things. But you know how and where. So there's a lot of details that have to be decided in order to make sure that we can implement this whole procedure call thing in a robust manner. So there's this thing called an application binary interface. And basically this is just the interface between the program and the system at the binary level. It includes rules about a lot of things, but in particular today we're interested in rules about how procedure calls are implemented. So these rules are referred to as calling conventions. And so we're gonna study the standard x86-64 calling conventions, which specifies how control is transferred back and forth between the caller and the callee. How data is transferred in and out of the procedure, and then what means the callee has for storing local data. So the basic idea here is that we're going to use the system stack to remember where we came from and any important information about each function call. So we're going to create something called a stack frame. You may see this referred to elsewhere as an activation record. We're going to treat those terms as equivalent and prefer the stack frame term in this course. So basically, here's our system stack. So this is the bottom of the stack here at the high addresses. Remember that the stack grows from high addresses down to low addresses. So again, somewhat confusingly, the bottom of the stack is at the top of our diagram and the top of the stack is at the bottom of the diagram. And so for every function that gets called or every procedure that gets called, there's going to be a region on the stack associated with that procedure. So in this particular example, we have a frame for P here, and then we have a frame for Q here. And since Q is sort of higher on the stack, closer to the top at the lower addresses, it is the callee. So P has called Q here. Okay, so that's what we're going to do. Every active function or procedure is going to have a frame, and the frame is going to store all the information about a single active call. So any arguments or local variables or return addresses. Incidentally, if you ever use the backtrace command in GDB to help figure out where you are in the program, this is how GDB gives you that information. It just kind of follows the chain back up the stack. And one really nice thing about doing procedure calls this way is that recursion just works. We don't actually have to do anything special for recursion because it'll just be another, every recursive call will just be another stack frame. Okay, so how does this work? The most basic thing that makes this work is using the stack to store return addresses. So very simply, every time we call a procedure, we push the return address onto the stack, and then whenever we return, we pop that address off of the stack. So here's an example from your textbook. So here is a function main. Inside of main, we call foo. And then in foo, we do something, and then we return from foo. So here is a picture of the machine before the call is executed. So we have the stack pointer pointing to somewhere in memory, and then the instruction pointer is pointing at this instruction that's about to execute. So when the call instruction executes, it's going to push the return address onto the stack. So the return address here is the address of the next instruction. So that's this address, the address of this move instruction right here. So it's going to push that address onto the stack. So you can see that the stack has now grown by, you know, 64 bits, which is the size of an address in x86-64. So that return address is now on the stack. And so that means that now we can jump to foo, and we can execute foo knowing that whatever we do on foo, the return address, the place that we want to go to, is going to be there at the top of the stack when we need it. And so when we execute the return, we'll just pop that address off of the stack, and we'll set the, we'll basically just jump to it. We'll set RIP, or the program counter, to that instruction. So that's the basic core concept that makes all this work, is being able to push things onto the stack and pull them off in the reverse of the order that we put them on. And so the most core, most important part of this is being able to store and retrieve the return address.